I'm looking at me when I'm walking past the mirror. Don't stress through the night at a time and my life ain't worried about if you feel it. Got my head on straight, I got my vibe right, I ain't gonna let you kill it. See, I won't change my life.
Hello and welcome to A Seat at the Table. I am Christine White.
And I'm Monica Pearson. Today we are finding our roots.
I'm Denine Milner. We each took a DNA test to find out more about our family origins. So let's get straight to the results.
I'm excited because I had this done once before and all it told me is that my family was from the Bemalike people in Cameroon. So... Yes, and what we really want to know is which one of us has more white blood so we can really pick on...
You know what? Okay. Always picking on the light skin folks. Okay.
This says, aha! Denine is going to be upset. I'm about 78% sub-Saharan African, with about 72% of that coming from West Africa. I'm 19.6% European, mostly from Northwestern Europe. And I have some Native American DNA as well, which I knew about the Native American. But, okay.
Okay.
Wow. The blackest of the black.
Let me tell you. 79% sub-Saharan African, with 73% of that coming from West Africa. Yeah, don't let the light skin fool you. And a little East Asian and Native American DNA mixed in.
So...
So I'm trumped you, yes.
Okay, so... Hello. Blackity black black. I'm about 89% sub-Saharan African,
okay.
With that's about 84% of that coming from West Africa. And I took a DNA test testing my mitochondrial DNA, and I'm from Cameroon.
Oh, wow.
We're sisters.
We are.
Literally.
We are people. The Tikar tribe. And I'm 9.4% European, mostly from the Northwestern Europe. And I have some Southeast Asian and South Asian blood as well, which explains Mari's eyes.
So,
wow, okay.
What were you European?
19.1.
Oh.
Yeah, see?
And what were you European?
9.4.
And I'm 19.6.
You can never tell.
Yeah, so
yeah,
I'm
Monica,
the whitest.
You are the whitest of us all. Yeah. You just go ahead and embrace those
and
roots. Embrace
those roots. Some people would say that's the case anyway.
So you guys know, though, that this is, like, huge for me, right? Because
yeah.
I'm adopted. And so this is the first time that I'm seeing, like, these percentages broken
right.
down.
Right.
Like, I took the other DNA test that kind of said where my roots stretched, like, where my roots stretched to, which was, again, Cameroon. But this right here, you know, is just something else to see. And, you know, when I go to the doctor and I'm asked for... you know, my medical history, when someone asks me where I'm from, if I'm standing in front of a Haitian, I look like I'm from Haiti. If I'm standing in front of a Nigerian, I'm from Nigeria. If I'm standing in front of a Jamaican, I'm Jamaican. And now I like, have this
yeah.
here. And that is, this is something else.
Deep.
It really is.
But let me tell you what strikes me, is that somehow we all ended up with European DNA.
I only have
9.4%. Not a surprise.
I think that it's when I think about our history and I try to reach back and imagine all of my ancestors, I very rarely picture someone who is white. And when I do, it is a slave, like a rape scene in my head.
Well, I knew from my mother that my great grandmother was Irish. So I knew there was some percentage, but I also knew that my great-grandfather was of Indian heritage and African-American. So it was an African. So for me, I guess the biggest surprise is the 19.6 European, because that means there was more than my Irish grandmother.
Right, right, right.
Right, right. Wow. I'm sorry, can we... circle back to me being the blackest one at the table.
I mean, yeah, well, you know.
We were hoping you weren't so we could tease you. But the reality is you have said from the beginning, I'm the blackity black black one. And now you can wear that proudly. So as far as the census, what are you going to sign now?
say I'm black. I don't really know why, you know, there are reasons why there's even a check mark or place to put race on the census, and that's to reflect how black people are treated in society. I am treated like a black person in society, so I'm going to always check black.
But it's interesting when you go over to Europe, and they don't think of us first as black Americans.
Right.
As you said, Nigerian, for me, it's always Senegal because of my pea head.
Right.
They think I'm from Senegal, mm-hmm. and they speak French. Mm-hmm. But I think this gets to the point that so often we are defined by race first rather than finding out who we really are.
Right.
Right. Now, we know a little bit more about where we come from, but what about the rest of the world? DNA evidence points to one woman as the mother of all humankind.
Mitochondrial DNA, found in our cells, is the genetic signature passed down through females from mother to child.
What it means is that this was a woman, hypothetically, who lived 200,000 years ago, who had enough daughters in a continuous chain, straight back, so that her mitochondrial DNA survived.
Absolutely right.
And all of us today, no matter what we look like, are descended from black ancestors?
Yeah, that is exactly. That's what happened. All the humans, all the Homo sapiens all over the world, be it yellow, white, black, we are all descended from a common ancestor in Africa.
Don't you love that? Particularly when you tell that to white people, you know, when we go all the way back, all of us, Eve, was a black woman.
Right.
Well, we are
right.
all related. We're all cousins. I mean, we talk about this all the time. It's how we're all one big human family. It's just hard to live that in day-to-day life, I think, just because of the way our culture separates us, particularly here in America. It's not the same in Europe or anywhere I've ever been, where I feel so different when I walk into rooms.
Right. And when you look at people who come here from other countries, who look African-American, but are African or maybe Hispanic, they are treated as if they are born here in the United States until they speak. Right. And then it's like, oh, you're not one of them. You're different. You're a foreigner.
Right.
And so then they get sometimes better treatment
yeah.
than we do.
Which is really just weird. And
it's very strange.
Especially when they play into that and kind of use that to divide all of us. My thing is, if you were standing on the corner of 68th and Broadway or Park in New York, and the cab passes you by, you're black as hell.
You're black.
Right?
that's the indicator.
Period.
That's the
Nobody
indicator.
Is, the cab driver is not going by and saying, oh, you look Ghanaian, so I'll stop.
Right.
Even if he is black.
Precisely. Precisely.
So all humankind actually started in Africa, but how did we get here? Many would point back to slavery.
The number of Africans who were transported as slaves directly to the United States is about 400,000. But by 1860, the number of slaves had grown to nearly 4 million.
That is frightening. When you think of how many of us were brought over, then how many more were brought over,
right.
and then we actually started reproducing.
Right.
And what happened, there was this separation of you could not speak your language.
Right.
You were separated, the mother from her child, the father from the woman, because the man became basically a breeder, as did the woman.
Right.
So we are still dealing with what started then. Remember when they had the house slave versus the field slave, which started pitting us against each other?
Absolutely.
And there would be this breeding, the rape of black women, that would produce a biracial child that then would get more privilege
right.
because of the color. So then that starts this fight between
right.
us.
Between right. us, right.
And that goes back to that dark skin, light skin thing. But, and of course, people ask me all the time, well, you obviously have some European in you. Why don't you embrace your white heritage the same way you embrace your black heritage? But it's such a sad history, and it's such a painful history. And I don't have any stories of white ancestors who were in the lives of my family. So my assumption is, and whether it be right or wrong, that it was a rape-forced situation, a painful situation. And so it's hard to identify with that part of our history.
So much so. Well, you know, that's the reason I like Henry Louis Gates' documentary, Finding Our Roots, which is seen here on PBS, because at least it gets people in touch with where they came from,
right,
but still trying to understand how we were so mistreated.
Right.
Just because of the color of our skins and because we didn't speak the language.
Yeah.
But there was never this sense that we were capable, even though we came here not knowing the language and learned it.
Right.
Created things that did not exist here before, mm-hmm, from the traffic light to,
right,
whatever. Mm-hmm. We still were not considered human beings of worth or value.
Right.
Well, I do believe that because of the way that we were segregated for so long, there a culture arose that we became associated with. So our skin became an indication of not just where we were from, but also a culture that we carry. And I think that that has been a lot of the reason for the friction. I don't know if it's one way or the other, actually. I mean, what do you think? Do you think that people have used our culture as a reason to mistreat us? Or do you think that they have mistreated us because they resist our culture?
I think it's a combination of both.
I agree.
You know, but I'll tell you this story. When Nick and I first started dating, we went down to South Carolina from an NABJ conference to find his roots because he heard from a 95-year-old grandmother before she passed that there was a specific woman that started sort of the black line of his family.
Right.
And it was in Edgewood, South Carolina.
Right.
And so we went there, and journalists, we put our journalist hats on, and we were able to track down his family straight from the first boat from Ireland.
Wow.
And the woman who was helping us, the librarian, a white woman, he tells her the story that he got from his, I think it was actually a great-great uncle who was 95. And the story was that there was a woman named Eliza who was raped on the 17th birthday of the slave master's,
wow,
son. Like, this was his birthday present to himself, was
Jesus,
to go and rape this woman. And she had a baby, and that was the start of,
wow,
and her name was Eliza. And this woman looks at us, looks at my then boyfriend and says, well, you know, they weren't all just, you know, rape. Some of them had relationships and actually loved one another.
No such thing.
And let me tell you something. Nick cried. Like, it literally brought,
yes,
tears to his eyes. I just wanted to choke her. Like, you don't get to take this history
and reframe it.
Reframe it so it makes you feel better.
Yeah.
This is what happened to us. There is no way that a slave has the power, the ability, the authority to be able to resist or say no to,
right,
someone who owns her,
right,
and can punish her in any kind of way.
Right.
So, you know, when you think of it that way, when you think of someone standing in a library with all of this information at her fingertips, and her first inclination is to say, oh, it wasn't rape. Sometimes they love one another. You can see how they don't see,
right,
how they can have our blood in theirs.
It's too much.
Because,
right,
in many instances, it was that. It was rape. And the minuscule ones. Because even if there was the love attached, once the husband died, the property was taken from her.
Absolutely.
And that was the end of it.
Right.
The only way you could be better off is if you were a freedman and going up north.
Right.
We got to take a break. But when we come back, we'll talk about race as a social construct.
Every living person shares a common direct maternal ancestor. She's known as Mitochondrial Eve.
Our common ancestry through the Mitochondrial Eve means that our genetic differences are literally skin deep, that at the bottom, we are all descended from the same family.
Okay. All right, does anybody know what the name of this place is?
That's Africa. I know that.
That's right, that's Africa. But did you know that Africa is the place where the body of the first man was found? My daddy says that makes it the place where all people originated from. That means everybody's really from Africa. Everybody. All y'all.
All y'all. Welcome back to Seat at the Table. Little Trey was dropping some knowledge. If everything started in Africa, what's up today?
I mean, you know, at some point, we decided that we were going to make dry line in the sand. I mean, nothing in creation is exact. We all live on a spectrum of something. And we decided we're going to draw a line in the sand and say, these people are black and these people are white and these people are Asian. And, you know, that's kind of what we do, is categorize.
Right. But if what Bill Nye, the science guy, mm-hmm. my kids love him. If a Papua New Guinean hooks up with a Swedish person, all you get is a human. There's no new thing you're going to get. You're just going to get a human.
But people don't see that. They have to separate us so that they can discriminate against us and therefore ignore us. And then it's a case of what you say so often, it becomes ego. If I'm light, bright, and damn near white, or if I'm white, I am better than you.
Right.
And don't even try to be near me. It even comes to the point where children who are biracial, there's this discussion about whether or not they should be identified as black or white. And most black children, you know, biracial children, will say, I'm black. Now, you look at these two young women. They're mixed-race twins, Lucy and Maria. They have the same mother and father. The mother is biracial.
Right.
The father is white. And this is what you get. Genes will always out. But the point is people...
That's their snatchback.
So how do they describe themselves? What I've found with a lot of my biracial friends, they gravitate to how they've grown up.
Right.
Most will say, I'm black. But then you get into entertainers, Mariah Carey. Most white people say, well, she's white.
Right.
And she kind of goes back and forth between the two. Halle Berry says, I'm black.
Right.
Well, there's a reason. It's a historical, societal construct. It all stems back to capitalism, as far as I can tell. And I think that, you know, as long as they could separate people and make a dollar from separating people, then they figured out how to separate people. And so that's when they decided that there was going to be a one-drop rule. It's more economical for someone with one drop of black blood to be able to be sold. So if you have one drop of black blood, you're black.
But do you remember the woman in New Orleans, the white woman, who when she found out she had African blood in her, said, oh, no!
Right.
And that's the point. How is it that one drop...
Wait, but you know, there's a whole just sort of industry. Before they took down Stormfront after Charlottesville, you guys know what Stormfront is.
Oh, yeah. What is that?
It's a website where, like, basically...
White supremacists get together.
White supremacist on the universe would congregate on here and talk about, you know, everybody who was not white.
All right.
Well, before they got shut down, they were in the middle of discussing how to actually deal with the DNA test that we took. Because what was happening was these white men with their tiki torches and their, you know, their hoods were finding out that they had some black in their system. And they DNA, and they were taking it so that they could go into Stormfront and brag about how white they are.
That
and then they found
me.
Out how black they are, and it became a thing. So
that's
now there's,
hilarious.
You know, like they're either, you know, discounting the DNA test and saying that it's a plot to make everybody,
right.
you know, not
of course.
White.
Of course.
Or you should just completely discount this. Or, you know, if you have this percentage, then you're white. Well, how about this? Y'all got almost 20%.
So I can join the white supremacist club. You know what? That reminds me of the Dave Chappelle show. Remember he had the blind black white supremacist?
Yes.
And he just knew he was white. And if he sounded like a Southern white man.
Oh my God,
was around here calling everybody all types of pejorative names, racial names, because he thought he was white. And the white supremacist was just happy to have like one more member in the show
to talk greasy about black folk. That
so
was
crazy.
Hysterical. Dave Chappelle is a fool.
Yeah.
But it could happen because
the
reality again, which you pointed out. All of a sudden, when they found out they had black blood, it's like, oh no, not me.
Right.
And it's not going to make any difference in how people perceive them, except in the white supremacist group.
Right, right.
It's like the guy from Atlanta who got arrested for beating up the kid in Charlottesville. He had a Hispanic name.
Oh, right. He had a
Latin name. His name was Ramos.
He had a Spanish name. Spanish is... European last time. I don't know. I mean, I just let's not get it twisted.
In the Latino community, there is a serious colorism issue.
Yes, for sure.
That is almost as bad, if not worse, than ours.
Particularly in Cuba.
Absolutely.
And Dominican Republic.
Puerto Rico and Dominican Republic.
Yes, absolutely.
And, you know, they will go out of their way to mistreat someone who looks like me. And I'll, you know, I'm from New York.
Right.
So, you know, there are all different kinds of communities. There could be a Dominican woman who looks just like me, and I don't know that she's Dominican until she opens her mouth and starts talking.
When I spent a semester in the Dominican Republic, they told me that they were all Spanish. They all came from the European Spanish ancestors, that all the indigenous people had been killed, and that they had not mixed with the slaves that were brought to the island. So they were all Spanish. But what a lot of the DNA testing is showing is that there is lots of indigenous blood still.
Of course there is.
Yeah.
I mean, that's crazy talk.
And as we see, it, you know, this intermixing that happened during slavery, it happened. And so everyone is mixed with everything.
Right. But then there are still myths that we have to deal with as Black people. You know, we're all athletic and we all know how to dance. We all have a great sense of rhythm.
Well, this goes back to the social construct, right? So we create these categories, and then we associate these attributes with these categories. But there's none of these attributes or these categories are real. Like, there's nothing in science that says that if you are have browner skin, you're going to run faster. Like, there's just no scientific evidence to support that.
I am blown away and really trying not to cry at this table. I know that I've been laughing a lot and making a lot of jokes, but it is something else to find this out about myself. And I'm so grateful to the producers for making this one of the topics for the show. Because it's something to know what's in your DNA.
It is.
You know,
it is.
It's something to know where you come from.
Yes.
And adopted children, as much as we love our parents and we connect with our parents and we consider them our parents, there is something to knowing what is in your blood.
Yes.
Everybody deserves that information.
Yes.
Everybody should know that. And so I'm so grateful for this moment. And I'm going to, as soon as we're done, go and call my daughters and tell them.
Oh. Yes, absolutely, baby. You are African, okay?
Yes. And she's so happy. Well, you know, my mother, that was the whole reason we did the DNA test the first time, because my mother never knew her father. As a matter of fact, her father had said to her, you couldn't be my daughter because you're light-skinned, you don't look like me, and actually took her brother, who was brown, away. And they didn't get back together until they were much older. And so my mother always used to say, I know who my heavenly father is, but I really don't know who my earthly father is.
Wow.
And that was the reason I did the DNA test for her.
Right.
And she embraced being from Cameroon, and she did her research on it, and that the Bamileke people were the merchants and smart. And she said, this is where it came from. So when she died at 93, she had a place.
Right.
She knew where she, her ancestors had come from.
Wow.
And that to her was like the piece she needed to go on.
Yep.
For me, when I look at it, you know, I just look at how we use race to discriminate and separate rather than to bring together. So for me, I don't want to talk about race so much unless it's human race, because when you strip away this veneer, underneath we are all the same. Is that going to happen in my lifetime? Do we get to that? Maybe by the time this so-called melting pot we have in America, when more and more color is added, and they say it's going to happen by 2030,
we're all going to be tan.
Right. We all are going to be tan, and that'll be the end of that. We're still going to have somebody out there trying to say, I'm all white, and we'll be able to go, you're the minority now, so we don't want to hear it.
Right, right.
Well, I will tell you the truth. When they, when slavery was over in Mississippi, my father says that the grown people on the plantation took all the kids and made them their kids, whether they were their kids or not. Mm-hmm. And I think that we have all, as a people, whether or not we are adopted in the immediate or we have sort of this idea of being adopted back, generations back, there's a disconnect between where we came from. And so that need to know where we came from and that desire to know who we are, I think is valid. Absolutely. And I think that we see that, you know, in America, when people try to say, no, you're not this, you're not Indian American, you're American, but people have a desire to be connected to where they're from. And I think that we should allow people to have that connection.
I agree. This has been absolutely an amazing, amazing conversation, experience.
My black
Yes, ma'am.
We have to go, but the conversation doesn't end here.
Share your thoughts with us on social media.
And we're on Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram, and Pinterest at ASATTTV.
Thanks for joining us for A Seat at the Table. And in the words of Shirley Chisholm, if they don't give you a seat at the table,
bring a folding chair.
What exactly is your problem?
How much time you got, buddy? Where would I start? Well, first of all, they're lazy, good-for-nothing tricksters, crack-smoking swindlers, big butt-heaven, wide-nose-breathing all the white man's air.
White power!